said I bought you. Yeah, we should roll a pound and count it. Yeah, look at all these heads that I bought you. Yeah, come and help me mount them. Won't stop till my driveway got a fountain. I done quit so many jobs, you would think that I'm a quitter. Really, I need quick cash, I just need it quick, fast. So I hit that field till that kid got that big stash. Shit.
What's poppin', everybody? You were listening to The Urban Product. It's your boy, DME.
It's your boy, Cozy Rich.
It's your girl, Imani.
And today we have a very, very special guest with us, you feel me? Hailing all the way from New York, we have Abby Jasmine. Abby, how you doing today?
Hey! Crazy. I feel good, guys.
Feel great. All right, so how you been doing during this, how have you been doing during this quarantine, you feel me? COVID, coronavirus and all that?
Shit, I just been trying to stay busy. I just been trying to, I don't know, just stay active. Like, I've been playing a lot of Sims. I taught myself how to cook. It's different over here.
Did you say Sims? You're playing Sims out of all things?
Yes, I was just playing it before, like, I hopped in the shower to get on the call with you guys. Like, it's different.
I respect it.
Nothing wrong with Sims. The Sims is great.
I mean, how's the city looking like with reopening too? Is everything still shut down? Are you guys all coming back one by one?
So I think New York City has like the lowest percentage or lowest like coronavirus like reports right now.
Since when?
So we're in since the I don't know if that's true though.
Nah, it's true. It's true. New York, New Jersey, and Mass got the lowest
reach right now. They not playing. Yeah. Like, they had us indoors, like, nothing was open, and now they in, like, the phases of reopening. So we have, like, I think 4 phases of reopening, and I think we're on phase 3. So I think phase 3 was, like, they just allowed, like, retail stores and, like, outdoor seating and, like, beaches and shit to open. Like, I just went to the beach the other day. It was fire. I enjoy myself.
Yeah, we gotta make sure we don't let these niggas from Texas, fucking
right,
Miami, pull up.
No,
yeah,
because no.
She's about to restart this all over.
Right. Stay your asses home.
A fucking. All right, but great. Yeah. So you had a great day so far today. You ready for this? Ready to get into the crux of this interview?
I'm ready. I got my weed. I'm ready.
I respect it. See, hey. I wish I had something on me. I wish I had something on me right now.
Come on, guys.
Sorry. Well, next time. Next interview. We do another interview. I'll match you over the Zoom call.
Right. Wow.
That's respect, actually.
That is respect. I fuck with that.
Niggas might have me go on my Duffy, but I won't for this.
Right now. By the way, Abby, happy belated from all of us. We know your birthday was earlier this month, so... You know what I mean? Happy 22nd birthday this year.
Thank you. I feel old. I feel like big sis right now.
What'd you do for it?
My friends threw me a rooftop party, like on my roof. Like they came, like I was like kind of gonna do that anyway. But like no, but like it wasn't gonna be on the scale that they like they had the grill. They went and bought the grill and they grilled food and Bel Air had like shipped me like a case of champagne and shit. Got me, yo, it would not have been on the scale that they did it. Like they did it up for me. And like my friends pulled up. It was dope. I had fun.
Every since Shorty said I like my Bel Air on ice, they've just been hooking her
right.
up since.
Yo! Right.
I respect that. Nah, I respect that shit.
I needed a next thing I need is a weed sponsorship. Like, that's all I need.
How's the exotics out there?
She had a big one.
No way.
Come on.
I already know the vibes. That's fine. I know the
right. Vibes. Like, come on. Like,
the strength of that answer.
It's like, you know, it ain't no Zaza. Ain't nothing crazy.
Mm-hmm. I feel you.
But I bet. But no bull, right? So you just came out with a recent project, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Who cares, right? Who cares the name of the recent project?
Yes.
And It was a lot of songs on there. Right now, it's 9 songs. And I just wanted to ask you, what was your favorite song from that project?
My favorite song off that project, right now is probably, that's a good question. It's probably the intro track, 2020. Okay. That's probably my favorite one right now, just because I feel it.
You feel that one?
Yeah, like, it's just like, I gotta get back to like focusing. Like I'm all over the place right now. I'm like in 10 different places at once in my mind. So I gotta get back to it.
Yeah, 9 times out of 10, what like starts a project off, you know it's gonna be fire or trash depending on the intro. Right. You feel me? And I say that about every single project. So like with this one, when I heard 2020, I was like, okay, Abby's talking nice for this one. I can settle.
So I'm not even gonna lie to you, Abby. Like, I wasn't even hip to your music until earlier this week when Dev told me like we scheduled you for an interview and everything. Mm-hmm. So I just started like going through Apple Music, SoundCloud, YouTube, checking out your shit, right? And I stumbled across your first project, Trap Mom. And okay. the sound you got from that is completely different from the sound you have on Who Cares.
I know.
So I just want to, and I'm not even gonna lie, my favorite song on that track, 1090, that shit goes hard, because you're talking your shit. That message, you're talking your shit in those songs. So I just wanted to say, like, or ask you, what was the main difference for you creating that project and then Who Cares, like?
I think the main difference was like Trap Mom was like my first project. I had just gotten signed to the label that I'm signed with now, Cinematic Music Group, and I was just doing a lot of like recording, and I feel like I was scared to like kind of break outside of my shell, just because like I didn't know how people were gonna like receive it, you know, like. Most times, bitches be like, oh, this bitch doing music now, whatever. So I was just kind of, like, scared, in a sense, to kind of break out my shell. Whereas, like, now it's, like, I've been doing this shit, like, 3 years. It's a little bit easier for me to write. Like, you know, practice makes perfect on everything. So, like, just through the years, like, the main difference, I guess, is just experience, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, that's what's up.
I be rambling. I have ADHD, so if I go off on a tangent, like, please let me know.
Nah, we all going to let you. Don't worry about it. Just going to let you.
Yeah, we all for it.
That's what this podcast is all about.
Nah, what's crazy? I was going to say this, too. Like, it seems like in your music, you have this, like, real, like, I don't give a fuck attitude. Like, you speak your mind, and to have your EP now, you know, titled Who Cares, like, how did you, were you always this person, like, you didn't give a fuck about what, you know, people thought, or were you just now became this new person where it's like, I'm just gonna do what I want to do and not really care about what's gonna happen afterwards?
Okay, so to an extent, like, I've always been a person that just kind of did whatever, like, I wanted, you know, like, my mom always called me, like, the wild child, because I was just, like, the craziest one, and I was always just doing whatever I wanted to do. I didn't really care about, like, what anybody had to say, but when it came to, like, music and just, like, making it, I think the problem was that, like, I did care too much, you know what I mean? So, like, when I would make projects, I would think about more so, like, oh, how are people going to take this? This doesn't sound like so-and-so. This doesn't sound like so-and-so's music. You know, this isn't like your average, I guess, mainstream music that's out right now, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, shit. So, yeah. So I think it came down to a point where I was tired of having people, like, so many people have so many opinions, like, even coming down to, like, the inner workings, industry people, like, I was kind of just fed up on everybody having so many opinions. And I was like, listen, stop. I'm going to do this one by myself. It wasn't even really a plan, but it kind of turned out that way. Like, my boyfriend Levy and my engineer, like, we kind of just made this project, just the three of us, like, in a room type shit. And the title came out kind of weird too, because it ended up being like, how are we gonna market this? What are we gonna call it? Because they were trying to like come up with like all these like tacky ass names, and I was just like, who cares? Like, you know what I'm saying? Who gives a fuck what we call this shit? Like, the music's fire. People gonna fuck with it. Yeah. So we was just like, you know, that's kind of a cool name, and I was like, yeah, let's fuck with that. Who cares? And
that's how it came about it.
Yeah, and now I just don't care about what anybody has to say to me, you know. So yeah, now.
That's what's up. That's the age to do it. Right. So you don't start now, it's gonna go down.
You gotta start early. You gotta start early.
Yeah.
Very true, very early in your career also. So like what Rich and Imani were saying earlier about how your like your style kind of changed in between projects. Cause you know, obviously to me, I feel like the track that put you out there was Long Live, you feel me? Yeah. And of course that was over the Baka Not Nice and Smile. So we didn't really know your sound completely until you dropped like Tags and Message after that. And then we were like figuring out what the Abby Jasmine sound was like. But now when you get like to but now when we get to Who Cares, I feel like we have a better understanding of what your sound is like now, you feel me? And just that jump from the first project with the two EPs and then to this project now. Like, do you think having the creatives around you, like Levy and your engineer, do you think, like, having all those people together in one room helped really define your sound? Or would you say you're still looking for it?
I would say now I want to kind of take the sound that I made on this last project and just kind of enhance it. You know what I'm saying? Like, not every song, like, there's not one song on that tape that, like, sounds the same, you know what I'm saying? So I want to keep kind of like that, just because, like, I want to be able to do, like, everything, you know what I'm saying? Like, if somebody hits me up and they're like, yo, Abby, we want you on this country track, I want to be able to, like, go and be on a country track, you know what I'm saying? So that's why I like to just keep things, like, versatile and, expand on what I have currently, because I feel like that's what people like, and that's what people have grasped to the most right now. Like, people play this shit every day. Like, I've never gotten a reaction from any of my projects like this, so this is crazy.
Yeah, facts. And I especially love the fact that, like, with Who Cares, you're kind of showing people more of your vocal range and your singing ability and all that, but you're still keeping the rapping in there too. I fuck with that a lot.
Thank you.
What made me a general, like, fan of Abby Jasmine, because before I was just Abby Jasmine off, like, Vine and IG and all that shit. Right. But what got me into the music of Abby Jasmine, no bullshit, was No Hook. When I heard that come on, I was like, oh, all right. I was like, all right, shorty pulling up different. I see the vibes now.
I feel like I got a rap just because it's like, that's what I was doing at first. So it's like, if I just pull up on niggas and I'm singing, they'd be like, yo, this bitch singing? What the fuck? She was rapping. So, like, you gotta, like, give niggas that little, like, here, go ahead. I rap too. I could do all that shit. So, you know.
I just wanted to ask you, since you are you still in Staten Island? I know you grew up there, but all right. You still in New York, though, right? Okay. I bet. So, growing up in New York, in that music area, in the music scene, because we all know, like, it's New York, L.A., and, like, Atlanta when it comes to, like, three spots in America, essentially. What was it like growing up in the music scene, and, like, what really made you gravitate towards getting into music?
So, I wasn't really allowed to go out up until, like, maybe I turned, like, 17. So, like, a lot of it was just me kind of just teaching myself, like, because my parents didn't let me listen to, like, any type of music that wasn't gospel music. So, like, it was me kind of just, you know, teaching myself, like, just about, like, what's going on and, like, the culture. And then once I turned 18 and, like, I moved down my mom's crib, I was kind of, like, in a weird space, because it was like, what the fuck am I doing? Like, I don't have a job, I'm not going to college. It's like, let me just make some music, you know, and, like, see if that could work out for me. And, you know, thank God, like, it did, and, like, we here. But Yeah, the music scene, I didn't really grow up in the music scene. Yeah.
I hear it. So one question I did want to ask you though is did you ever meet Pop Smoke or anything like that? You ever associate with him?
I didn't meet Pop Smoke, but I went to his release party. Mm-hmm. That was like right before he passed away. We was at his release party and I was about to leave, like I was dead about to leave because my friends was waiting outside and Pop Smoke hadn't even came yet. And then right as I'm walking out the door, he comes in. I'm like, I can't leave yet. Like, Pop Smoke just got here, my nigga. Like, okay. So I watched him perform a couple songs. They was lit. The cops was like right outside, ready to like break it up, shut it down, whatever the fuck they was there to do. But it was dope. I'm glad that I stayed.
I just wanted to ask, like, how did his death really affect like the New York music scene in general?
I think that, I mean, Pop Smoke, they still play Pop Smoke out here. Everywhere you go, like, right. Niggas still play Pop Smoke. I be sitting in here and, like, niggas be riding down the street playing Pop Smoke. Like, Pop Smoke is, like, he's not physically here, but, like, he still ain't leave yet. You know what I'm saying? So, okay. I think shit is pretty much the same, you know?
That's crazy. Now, what in your life? Because we can say, you know, you blew up. You out here. You stood to a certain level, you know what I'm saying? So, no, I'm talking about that. So, you know, what in your life has changed the most since you've grown up? Negatively, positively, like, what changed the most?
I wouldn't really say anything's changed. Like, I still hang out with the same people. I do the same stuff. Maybe just the money that's in my pocket. Like, I'm able to go out more. I'm over 21 now, so I could, like, before I wasn't able to go anywhere and I just like was just smoking weed and just sitting in the house, but now like I could go out, so I guess that's changed the most. But like nothing really changed, man, like other than like my place of living and like the money that I got in my pocket, like life is still pretty much the same. And that's cool. Like, I'm cool with that.
How's the transition from, you know, really going from internet personality to now full blown out musician and artist? Like, did it take a while to get taken seriously in the game, or did you just have the support as soon as you came out?
Yeah, no, I definitely didn't. people didn't want to get me in their studios and nothing because, like, this bitch, now she want to do music. But, like, nobody really knew. Like, I've been playing piano, like, since I was, like, 8. Like, I've been singing in church. Like, I was always, like, into music. So, like, it didn't surprise, like, my family when that was, like, the career path that I kind of chose. But, like, everybody else was like, oh, my God, like, she's an internet bitch. Like, she's rapping now. But It took a while, and I feel like it's still, you know, taking some time, but I feel like people now are getting more in tune just because, you know, it's obvious that I'm not gonna give up, so you might as well just fucking listen to it, you know what I'm saying? Like, but, yeah, I feel like just as I keep getting better and shit keeps moving, like, that'll change, but yeah, it's still, people still are trying, like, to be like, oh, she's a rapper now, oh, she made music now. Like, bro, I've been doing this shit for 3 years, like, you know. Mm-hmm.
So, with that being said, though, I just want to ask you, like, you've been doing this shit for 3 years, like you said. I want to ask you, what's the best moment of your career so far, even though it is still pretty young?
The best moment would probably be, I think it was like when I, it had to be when I went on tour with T-Pain. Like, that shit was crazy. That was like my first ever tour. Mm-hmm. Well, I did like 3 shows with Rico Nasty. That was like a mini tour, but I don't know if that counts as a tour. Yeah, I did 14 shows with T-Pain. Like, we drove across the country in a fucking Sprinter. And yeah, that shit was dope. That shit was fire.
For sure.
Now, like, how did that even work out? Like, how did you meet up with, you know, T-Pain and Rico Nasty? How did that connection come across to you?
So with Rico Nasty, I think it was someone had contacted my management. Like, it was a promoter that had contacted my management and said that she wanted me to open up on a tour for her. So I was like, all right, bet, like, we out. So I did that. That was dope. And then with the T-Pain thing, at the time, we were both signed to the same label. Okay. So, yeah, they just asked me to open up on that tour, and that tour was fire. I think it was me, the nigga A1 from Love & Hip Hop, and T-Pain. Yeah.
Peep that eye roll. Nah, because I peep that eye roll, that's why.
Oh, my God. It was...
I feel it.
He's exactly like he is on TV. I'll give you that.
No, I believe it.
It's just crazy. It's not an act at all.
Oh,
consistency is key.
She got all the tea. All right, so I want to get into the actual music itself, right? So how long did it take you to create this project? Or how long were you working on it for?
I have made the first song around South by Southwest of last year. So about a year.
What was the first song?
Groovy. I had wrote Groovy first. It was supposed to, like, we were at a writing camp, and that we had just made that beat. I think we, like, took shrooms or some shit, and I don't know what the fuck happened, but we ended up making that song. And I was like, nobody's about to take this song, because it ended up just sitting around for a while, and I was like, nobody's about to take this song. Let me just keep this song, write a little song to it, and if people fuck with it, they fuck with it. And yeah, people fucked with it. Yeah, Guapdad on it.
Like, when you got Guapdad on that track, what was it like working with him? Like, when you were making that music video, because every time I see him, like, he seems like a clown. Like, he's a funny guy, pretty entertaining. So I'm just wondering, what was it like working on set with him for the music video?
That trip was mad fun. I think I asked them to get some Henny, like, asked us to, like, get us some Hennessy and shit too. And bro, I don't remember half of it. Like, it was just, that's how fun it was. Like, you know, like, when you just do something and you just in the moment so much, like, it was so fun. I think, like, I was drunk and I tried to fight this lady outside. Like, that's how fun it was. And you know when you try to fight somebody, you having a great night.
No, facts. I believe that. Especially
That's the Henny talking.
That's the Henny, right?
The Henny talking.
And then they bought us both, like, the personals, like, the shits that was this big. Mm-hmm. And we was just like, cheers. Taking them shits back. Like,
uh-huh.
I'm surprised I didn't look like a fucking drunk slob in that video, because I was so drunk.
So when you were sipping in the video, you were actually sipping.
Oh yes, I did that take like 5 times.
So, like, oh shit!
So, like,
that's funny.
Oh my god!
Right.
So how did the visuals even come about? Like, how did y'all do the what's that shit called? Y'all had like the genius like background, yeah, to it, and I was like, oh, that's dope. Like, how did that come about?
It's a spot out here that it's like a virtual reality arcade, I guess. So in the bottom, it's like all virtual reality games that you could like pay and then you play them for a little while or whatever. And then on the top floor, it's like a video or what do you call them? Like a video set or some shit. And they have like all the green screen stuff. So we like, when you see in the video, it's like him like walking to me, and there's like the set, and it goes from like green screen, and like, yeah, so we were in that spot and it was cool. Like, that was a really dope spot. I want to go back there and like play the games.
Nah, sounds like a finesse. That's dope. That's dope. I wish they had more shit like that out here. Like, so our artists out here had more access to stuff like that. You feel
Where
me?
Are you at?
We're from Massachusetts.
Boston.
We from Boston. Don't say Massachusetts, bro. We're from Boston.
I'm not sure that's true.
Okay, well, first of all, I'm from Malden. I'm not going to claim Boston because I'm from Malden.
Oh, yeah, true. I'm from Malden, but like, Boston, so they can say just Boston. To summarize it. We from Boston.
I live within 10 minutes of Boston. I'm from Boston. I live within 10 minutes of Boston. I'm claiming Boston.
About to watch this episode and be like,
"Who the fuck is he?"
From Boston.
You feel me? That's why I said Massachusetts. That's why I said Massachusetts. It's like that's like why Buffalo says they're from Buffalo and not New York. You feel me?
Right.
They'd
be like, "Wait,
niggas be doing that
not New York." You feel me? Yeah. If you ain't repping that set, don't say you're from there. You feel me? Simple.
Right.
New York and Boston, two completely different environments, bro. No comparison. I'm comfortable walking around. You know what? Let me stop.
You feel me? But quick question. So with this tape, like I said, we hear the evolution. We hear the maturity in the content as well. When it comes to the lyrics, is it singing more? Like, what was the most difficult part in that creative process? You feel me? Because I can understand how you could probably just be sitting with that tape for a while, you know, not sure what to put out or how to sequence it. So how did you go about it?
Okay. So as far as the sequencing, well, it was kind of hard for me to finish it just because I felt like this is something that could either be like really good, or if it's executed horribly, could just like kind of flop. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I thought it was important to get out of our usual surroundings. You know what I'm saying? Like where we usually record, and we went to the Poconos, and I had got like a cabin on Airbnb, and like me, Levy, my engineer, and my management had all gone out to the Poconos and just like to finish up working on the tape. And I feel like that's just what I needed though, like just to finish it. Like being stuck in one place and trying to kind of narrate these different experiences, like I feel like you have to get out of your regular experience to like talk about different shit, you know? So I think going on that trip definitely helped me be able to finish it, because like it was sitting for a while and part of me was like, I don't even know if I should put this shit out, but like I'm glad I did.
Mm-hmm. What do you do when you're having those moments of doubt? Like, do you still have those self-doubt moments? And if you do, how do you get over it? How do you, you know what I mean, just
I do not all the time, but like there are some times where I'm just like, bitch, like you could be doing better than this, like you, come on. But I think that's when I feel like I'm over analyzing myself too much. So what I'll do is like I'll just go back to like listening to music like how I used to before I made music, you know, like, and just listen to like some albums or like, you know, and get my mind off it, you know, like just smoke a blunt, watch a movie, anything to get my mind off of that. And then once I come back, you know, I'll have like a better confidence, just because when you listen to something over and over and over and over again, it's like, damn, like is this shit even good, you know? Because like that's like when you watch a movie like 20 times, it's like, damn, is this movie even fucking good? Like I don't know about this shit. But yeah, you gotta kind of just step away and like analyze it from the outside looking in, even though it's like hard to analyze something when you're so deep into it. It's just important to like look at it how somebody else would look at it instead of how you would look at it, you know?
Facts.
Is there anybody that like you would say influences you while you in these tough moments, or is there like a certain artist or certain album that you look back to you know, inspire you to write your music?
I wouldn't necessarily say like artist. I would just say in these times, I would probably kind of go back to like not specific artists, but just like albums that I kind of grew up listening to and like being a fan of, you know, just to, I guess, gain that inspiration back. So like one of the albums I always go back to is like Views. Views is a really good album. The Drake album.
I talk mad shit about that album.
Yeah, we be talking hella really? Shit about that album. Yeah.
I talk mad shit about
out of all his projects, God. Views.
The intro is crazy.
Ah!
Guys, don't do that.
Ran out of ass. Or what?
Relax.
Custom no. leather, best.
I'm gonna let y'all have that.
Relax. Because if that's what it is to let her make these type of music. Yeah,
y'all can't be talking shit about Views. What?
Now you got
what's your favorite Drake album?
My favorite Drake
mine?
Album?
Nothing was the same.
Nothing was the same or Take Care.
Talk right, to
I can understand Take Care. Nothing was the same was...
Hold up. Yeah. Let me hear this. Let me hear this. Nothing was the same was what?
That's was not fire. My favorite Drake album.
Shorty is putting... Shorty's putting Hotline Bling over Pound Cake, bro.
No! We got other sauce.
Nah, cause the outros, bro.
Oh, I can't accept this. But I'm gonna let y'all ride.
Nah, what's called? So who you listening to right now? What you got in your rotation?
K-Tronada's album.
Heard. Okay.
You heard that shit?
Nah, I know of him, but I don't listen to him.
She about to get us hit. She said get like, hit.
Cause you I don't gotta get in tune. Like K-Tronada's album is crazy.
Nah, I know it'd be a groovy ass vibe. I know it's a groovy ass vibe because yeah. He's going to work with like Goldlink and mad other people all the time.
Yeah, that's what I'm bumping right now. Like I bump that shit every day. Such a good song. Such a good album. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like that, there's this one Tinashe song that I fuck with right now that's crazy.
Let's fuck with Tinashe.
I love Tinashe. I met her at Fashion Week, and, like, I've loved her ever since. She's so nice.
Word.
Who else? Who else? Future, always.
Of course.
Future,
of course.
Always.
Of course.
Future for life. I feel like at this point, bringing it up is just like, all right, we get it. Like, you like Future. Like, I love him. Mm. That's my top one artist for life.
Facts.
Yo, I try to tell y'all, she knows. I try to tell y'all.
I wouldn't expect someone who titles their shit Trap Mom to not listen to Future. You feel me?
Right.
I see it and I respect it.
I love Future.
So, Abby, let me ask you this. So you are only 3 years in. And I know this question is probably like crazy to ask, but I want to know, what are your long-term like goals for your career?
I want to eventually get into, this is just like one out of like a bunch, but like this is probably my biggest one. I want to get into like writing for other artists. I want to write like I just told my boyfriend the other day, like I want to write a weed comedy movie, so I'm gonna start writing it, and hopefully in like the next couple years I can get somebody to like pick this shit up, because mm-hmm. it gotta be. Yeah, shit. Sorry, somebody called me. It gotta be fire. So yeah, I want to write a weed comedy.
That's thinking about like Devin and Matt go to school type shit, like with the
nah.
Okay.
Nah, that we gotta be honest. As like we have to like a lot of these weed movies is mids.
You see How High too?
That was the middest.
That shit was so.
That was the worst movie. That was the worst movie I ever seen.
God,
that was a standards. Really, really, really bad movie.
That's good though.
Nah, it was a really bad movie, guys.
Like, no, it was bad.
And they had top tier people in the movie too, which made it.
Yeah,
work.
Like yeah. Fly. They had Yachty, but I already knew like Yachty don't even smoke weed. Like, how you gonna cast Lil Yachty in a movie about weed smokers and he don't smoke weed?
If you're writing a weed comic, you just gotta make it New York as fuck for us, though.
Right.
You gotta make it New York as fuck for us.
Right. That How High too? Not it.
I just have a quick question because this has been sitting in the back of my mind for a while. Have you ever pulled back up to that target?
No.
No, you never went back to that target?
No. Mostly because there's no reason for me to go to that specific target. I live in Brooklyn now, so like,
oh, I feel
I don't need to go to Staten Island to go back to that target. I probably went back like after I had gotten fired a couple times, but like recently, nah. I just went to Target the other day though, and I got a DiGiorno's pizza.
Yo.
Oh my god.
Traditional? Yeah, traditional.
No,
right?
it was three meat. Pause.
I love that she had to say pause.
Right.
So New York, yo. No, it's just her story of her getting fired from Target is like one of the funniest stories I've heard before.
No, okay. That shit was fucking embarrassing because...
I mean, you got fired because you were popping.
No, but, like, do you want to know what happened? Like, I went in to Target because my schedule said that I had a shift. Like, they didn't even tell me they fired me. Like, I walked in. I had on my little red and khaki and shit.
You was probably jacking up everybody.
Right. I'm like, hey, what's up, guys? Everybody's looking at me like...
Oh, she don't even know.
Yeah, and I go in, I clock my number in, it said employee not found. I said, what? I said, what do you mean? I work here. So I went to HR. They was like, let me get management. Management had me sit and wait for an hour and a half just to tell me that they fired me. They took my name tag. Like, how you gonna take my name tag?
That's crazy.
Y'all don't even want the shirt back, but you want the name
right.
tag.
I mean, I had to buy my own damn shirt.
Oh, yeah. You were keeping your shit then.
Nah, I'm keeping my shirt. Like imagine they made me take off my shirt. That's wild.
That would have been crazy.
That's wild. Hey,
like, nigga, I walked in with a shirt. Now you want me to give it back?
Like, what are you about to do with the shirt?
No way, yo.
So, Target. Fuck you.
Yeah. Fuck Target.
Right. Fuck Target.
Freaking. I bet. But yeah, so I just want to know. So, the butt out here in Mass is kind of crazy. I want to switch.
I thought it was legal out there.
It is legal.
It is. Yeah. Nice.
Dev, you,
is that it, Dev?
You ain't out here. Like it's like that. It's like that.
Not out there. Heard. Okay.
Not out there. It ain't like that.
What, you trying to say that our shit's fire? Is that what you're trying to spin?
It ain't bad.
All right.
Nah, because I remember when I went to New York. I went to New York with my ex in April last year. Picked up some weed out there. Oh my god, that shit was trash.
That shit was so trash. I remember.
You're not going to the right people.
I mean, I feel like if I was to go to like, nah, you got. I mean, you're different because you got money.
Not even. I think you just gotta find people that like. You know what I be doing? I used to go on like weed pages. Like I would look up weed pages on Instagram and see if there were any like in New York. And usually, if you just DM them, like they'll come deliver to you. I be DMing them on my Finsta and shit, so they don't know that it's me.
The niggas advanced out here. They just start.
I ain't even gonna lie. That's a smart ass idea. I've never.
Okay.
Nah, they do shit on Snapchat, but that's how they scam people.
See, I don't have Snapchat, so I can't get scammed.
Smart.
It's a scam on Snapchat.
Cause what people are doing now, they be printing out the fake exotic packs, and then they just put in mid in the shit, and you can't even tell because you're just looking on it through like IG or like Snap or some shit like that.
Some nigga got broccoli one time.
Yeah, I remember up there, he got mid Reggie when I pulled up to New York. It was crazy.
Hell no.
That's why my standards are different.
It is what it is. I bet. So, what's the rest of your day or night looking like?
I'm about to go get my hair done. As you can see, I have this hoodie on. If I take this hoodie off, y'all are going to be like, bitch, go get your hair done because my lace front is not attached to my scalp. So I'm going to go get that situated. And then I'm going to get my nails done because I got to shoot a video tomorrow. And yeah.
You said my lace not attached to my scalp, it's attached to my hoodie.
You said her lace front.
I feel it.
Sometimes you just gotta like throw that shit on like a cap and just
like a cap.
Look, y'all wouldn't even know.
No,
until I told y'all.
You ain't gotta do all that.
Y'all think I'm just stuck in? Like, oh, she chilling. She in the house. She got a hoodie. Nope, my wig's not attached.
Nah, I feel you.
I like her. Oh, good news. You got nominated for, you know, XXL Freshman Class 2020. How you feel about that?
Yeah. It's lit. I got nominated last year, too.
Nice.
I don't really try to win things because if I try to win things and then I lose, I get very disappointed. So I kind of just let things be, and if they're supposed to happen, they'll happen. But it was nice to be thought of. It was nice that they thought of me. I have horrible pitches every year. So I think I'm going to make that like a tradition for as long as they keep inviting me back. I'm going to try and do the worst pitch possible. Like, at this point, it's like, let's just keep it going. Like,
I respect it.
Right.
I mean, also shout out to you because, like you said, you're not trying to win anything, but they also said you were one of the best albums that dropped this year.
Right. I was surprised. I was like, oh, shit.
Facts. Because out of, like, 2020, all of the crazy shit that's going on, the only good thing we've been looking forward to is the music. So we've just been getting a mass stream of just all this new music. And then you just were able to just, you know, get your way up.
Like, slap my way in there, right?
You're able to tell us when Poland Springs is dropping? I know you're dropping that video soon, but are you able to tell us when it's dropping?
No.
All right, I feel that.
Because we're in editing process, so I don't know when, but it's almost done, so it should be soon. All
right, and I'm also going to ask this because I see you've been ducking it on Twitter. You're not going to do anything with Do Better, are you? I feel because I've been asking her for a minute. I'm just like, hey, yo, Do Better is the one, but she's like, no, I'm going to do videos for these other tracks.
So what happened was, let me tell you why there's not going to be a video. So what happened, there was going to be a video, and it was going to be fire, and it was going to be claymation, which is cool, right? Ooh, wow. But, one, that takes a lot of time.
Facts.
They were talking about some 8 weeks, and I was like... Sis, that I, but you know, like, I just don't have 8 weeks to wait. So, I said I can't do it, man. But I really wanted to.
That's cool. That was just a personal one for me because that's my personal standout off that album. That's why. What are you calling? Are you calling an album, mixtape?
I let people call it how they want to call it.
Nah, I feel you. That's the case. I can't wait for whatever project you come out in the future. If you're going to dub that one as your debut album.
Right.
Whatever that sounds like. You feel me? Because then I know Abby will be in her pocket when she does that shit.
I'll be like, hey, remember that album I just dropped? Psych, it wasn't an album. This is an album.
Be like that. How's label support been?
It's good. I fucks with them. They treat me right. They keep me happy. It's a big happy family, and you know, they're a great bunch. They take care of me. Cool.
I've seen they've been pushing it, been featuring them on playlists. I see you getting talked about on these like the streaming radio shows they got with Apple Music and all that shit. So I'm like, okay, it's great when you got like label behind you. Are they just letting you drop whenever you got to drop, or you got to fall in like a certain deadline?
I kind of like plan my drops. We plan them together. Make sure there's like something solid behind them, all that, you know, nice and polished.
Mm-hmm. All right, word. So this will be my last question. You feel
okay.
me?
Okay.
Do you have? Are you like just cooling right now, or are you still working?
I'm working. I'm working.
All right, word. Well, I know you won't tell us what you're gonna drop next.
No, because
riding I'm the high. No fat, ride the high of this tape. You don't gotta give a shit right now. That's the thing.
I don't know what it is yet. I can't tell you what it is because I don't even know, but it's something.
Nah, you just get better with each tape, so that's fine.
Last question for me. Anyone in the game that you could get a feature from, who would you pick?
I feel like you can answer that question yourself.
Future?
Yes.
Hopefully he sees this shit.
Yes. I'm about to send this to him like, yo, I talk about you in every interview. Like, I'm going to make a compilation of, like, all the times I've ever spoken about Future.
Nah, it could happen. No bullshit. I feel like Future, being the type of guy he is and, like, his status.
He seems like a nice person.
Like, it's crazy.
I feel like he would be a really nice person.
I would love to chill with him for a day.
Right. Like, just chill. Smoke a couple L's. Like, you know what I'm saying? Let's chill.
Facts. That's a fact. That's a fact. That's a fact.
All right. My last question is... shit. I just had it. Oh, okay. No, I got it. All right. So, I first saw you off of, like, Vine and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know... I want to say the younger generation Vine is their TikTok. Mm-hmm. How do you have a TikTok? Is that like, do you feel like you get into it? Like,
so I have a TikTok. I got like 400 followers on that shit because like I don't use it.
Okay.
But I'm trying, like it looks cool. Like there's some like aspects of it that's cool, but like I just don't have the attention span to, like, try to really sit and edit these videos out. Like, when I was younger and, like, I didn't have shit to do and I would just be in my house all day by myself, like, that was different. Like, now I gotta go out and be places by a certain time. So, like, I don't have the time, but I'm gonna sit down and I'm gonna learn that shit.
Facts. Like, you're more involved in the music now. You're not really paying that much attention to social media. Yeah, because she got rid of all of her shit. She got rid of all her old shit. That's why. Can't find that shit anywhere now.
Gone.
Nah, and it's good because you're able to outgrow the, you know, she went from being, did you die though, girl, to now.
Right, and now I got my name. Abby Jasmine.
That's cool. That's cool. All right, Abby. What we normally do on this show is we normally like to give people, you know, we call it our vibes of the week. So if we want, I will let you... pick any song that you want. You know, normally I like to recommend people choosing their own song, but I would like you to have the chance to just, you know, drop any song that you want to drop for our listeners. Let them see what your vibe is like. You feel me?
All right. My vibe of the week is Artificial Lover by Abby Jasmine.
Boop. Facts.
Period.
All right, Abby. Yo, no bullshit. Whenever you're dropping music next, anytime you want to promote shit in Massachusetts, because if you want, you know, plug out in Massachusetts, your group, so just hit us up and we'll spread that shit around. You feel me?
I bet.
Facts. Mad niggas up here when it comes to New York, they really only fuck with the drill shit, but I'm going to open their ears to other shit too. You feel me?
Yeah. You can't just listen to the same shit. That gets boring.
Can't. All right, Abby, anybody else want to say anything before we file and dip?
Yeah, thank you for coming on the show. Good. You know what I mean? We really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me, guys. This was fun. Yeah, it was.
I liked it.
Facts. Thank you so much for coming out. And we'll definitely be sure to keep in touch, all right?
All right. I'll talk to y'all later.
Facts. All right, everybody. This has been Abby Jasmine. Thank you for joining us. You feel me? All y'all have been listening to The Urban Product. Once again, it's been your boy, DME.
It's been your boy, Cozy Rich.
It's been your girl, Imani.
And it's been your girl, Abby Jasmine. Bye!
Nice. We'll catch y'all next time on The Urban Product.
Oh.